Good morning, children. Let's begin with the second video of bio today, that is of the leaf. We are going to begin with types of leaves today. So, there are two types of leaf, children, depending upon their lamina of the leaf. Now, lamina is the green color portion of the leaf that you can see. Depending upon this lamina, children, the leaves can be of two types, simple leaves and compound leaves. Now, as you can see the picture of simple leaf, children, the leaves in which the lamina is not divided, that is, it is undivided and is in the form of a single piece, is called a simple leaf. In these leaves, the various margin incisions, if present, will not touch the midrib. Now, margin incisions means, children, as you can see over here, these cuttings are known as the margin incisions. So, in case if these margin incisions are very, very deep, they will not be as deep that they can touch the midrib. Then these kind of leaves are known as a simple leaf. And examples of simple leaf can be seen in a mango, children, in jamun, peepal, castor, cotton, china rose. So in all these plants, you can see and find a simple leaf. Next, we come to a compound leaf. Now, first have a look at the picture of a compound leaf, children. It is shown over here. This kind of leaf, you can find it in rose, gram, neem, peat, tamarind, etc. See, I have also brought a real compound leaf to show it to you. See, this is a real compound leaf, as you can see over here, children. These are known as the leaflets. These are all known as the leaflets. And this is a picture. This is a real compound leaf, as you can have a look at it. The leaves in which the lamina is divided into small segments which are attached to the midrib, that is known as the rachis, and its branches or tip of the petiole are called compound leaf. Now, as you had seen it right now, children, that these small leaflets, these are known as leaflets, children, they are coming and they are touching the midrib. Actually, in the beginning, this is a complete single leaf, and then it gets broken down, it gets branched into small leaflets. That is how it is known as a compound leaf. In these leaves, the incision reach up to the midrib. You can see the complete incisions. They are reaching to the midrib. They are coming and touching the midrib. Due to this, each individual leaf looks like a small group of small segments called the leaflets. So these small leaves that can appear over here, that can be seen over here, children, they are known as the leaflets, as you can see in the clear picture over here. So this is simple leaf and compound leaf. Next, we come to venation. Now, what is venation, underline, children? The arrangement of veins and veinlets in a leaf is known as venation. How the veins and the veinlets are arranged in a leaf, that is what is known as venation. Now, venation is also of two types, reticulate venation and parallel venation. Now, we begin with the first one, that is reticulate venation. When veins and veinlets are irregularly distributed, that means they form a complete network, it is known as a reticulate venation. You can see the veins and the veinlets are irregularly distributed in the lamina, forming a complete network. As you can see in this picture, children, a network can be seen, a net kind of a thing can be seen. This is commonly found in the leaves of a dicot plants. Now, plants are also of two types, children, dicot and monocot. So these leaves, that is showing reticulate venation, are found in dicot plants. You can, if you manage to see some leaves of peepal, mango or guava, you'll be able to see the reticulate venation very, very clearly. Coming to the next venation, that is parallel venation. When the veins and the veinlets will run parallel to each other, that means they are going to run parallel to each other, like the parallel lines, then that kind of a venation is known as parallel venation. Now, this parallel venation is found in the leaves of the second type of plants, which I told you right now. They are known as monocot plants, like sugarcane, wheat, maize, banana and bamboo. If you manage to see any of these leaves, children, you will be able to see the parallel venation. Now this I managed to bring a bamboo leaf and show it to you children. Have a look at it. See the venation. The veinlets are running parallel to the midrib. Have a look at it. See, you can clearly see now. They are running parallel to each other. See, and compare this with the reticulate venation. See, this leaf has the reticulate venation. You can see and you can make out the difference. So they have a network kind of a thing, and this leaf has a parallel veins that are running. So this is reticulate venation of a dicot plant, and this is the parallel venation of a monocot plant. Coming to next thing, children, that is known as phyllotaxy. Now phyllotaxy is a term which means how the leaves are arranged onto the stem of a plant is known as phyllotaxy. Underline, children, the arrangement of leaves on the stem is known as phyllotaxy. And why is phyllotaxy important, children? Because it does not let the overcrowding among the leaves takes place. The leaves are expanded out, and in order to, so that every leaf on the plant is able to get proper sunlight and air, so that they are able to do what is known as photosynthesis. Now phyllotaxy is of the three types over here. Let's see: opposite phyllotaxy, alternate, and the whorled. Now opposite means when two leaves arise on each node but in the opposite direction, it is known as phyllotaxy, is known as the opposite one. You can find it in tulsi, jasmine, and guava. Now have a look at this, children. From every node, two leaves are arising, but they are going in the opposite direction. They are coming in the opposite direction. Have a look at this. They are moving in opposite direction from the same node. So this phyllotaxy is known as the opposite phyllotaxy. Next we come to alternate phyllotaxy. When a single leaf arises from each node and the next leaf will arise from the next node but in the opposite direction is known as alternate phyllotaxy. As you will get it in rose, castor, peepal, mint, mango, etc. So the next leaf that will arise from the successive node but in the opposite direction, right? Somewhat like this, children. Have a look over here. Somewhat like this. See, one is arising from one node, the other is arising from the successive node in the opposite direction. See, right? It is somewhat like this. They go in the opposite direction from the successive nodes. Next is, even the picture very clearly shown over here, you can have a look at it. Next we come to the whorled phyllotaxy. That means more than two leaves will come out from each node and they will form like a ring. A complete ring kind of a structure is being formed. This is known as the whorled phyllotaxy, and you can see the example over here in the picture that is being shown. Let's see the functions of the leaves. Very important, children. The first and the foremost function of the leaf is to make food. The process by which green plants will make their food with the help of certain things, which are carbon dioxide and water, in the presence of sunlight and chlorophyll, which is present in the leaves, the green color pigment, is known as photosynthesis. Now this is the most important function of a leaf, because until and unless the leaves do photosynthesis, plants cannot survive. So photosynthesis is the most important function of a leaf. Next is the exchange of gases. Now from your junior classes you have been studying that the plants, they take in carbon dioxide and they give out oxygen. So that exchange of gases also takes place through the leaves. The leaves of the surface carry small holes which are known as stomata. There are innumerable stomata that are present, and more stomata are present on the underside of the leaf than on the upper side. Now this stomata helps in the exchange of gases, which is used for the purpose of photosynthesis as well as respiration. Like you do the respiration, plants also do respiration. So the exchange of gases is taking place through the leaves. Next is transpiration. Now we keep on pouring water in the say in the pot where the plants are there, or in the soil where the plants are there, children. Roots all the time keep on absorbing the water and they keep on transporting that water to the leaves. Now leaves, continuously they get the supply of water. But what will happen if the leaves store a lot of water? They will start decaying. But so that they do not decay, they have a process of throwing out the extra water. Now that throwing out of the extra water from the leaves in the form of water vapor is known as transpiration. And this transpiration also takes place through the tiny holes on the leaves, which are known as stomata. The next we come to, children, vegetative propagation. Now in certain plants, children, the leaves, they start developing the buds, and these buds can be used for the, say, for the new plant growth. The new plant can grow from these buds that arise from the notches on the leaves. That is known as vegetative propagation. And where can you find them? You can find them easily in a biofilm leaf. The last function of the leaves is they also help to store the food. Sometimes the leaves of certain plants, they become fleshy. Why? Because they store the food in them. Like onion, you know, all of you eat also onion, and you have seen onion, children. The leaves of the onion that you eat, they become swollen due to the storage of food in them. So with this, we come to an end of all the functions of the leaf and today's video. So that's it for today's video, children. I hope I made myself very clear to you and you have understood each and every point that I have explained to you in today's video. If you have really understood, you know what is to be done. Please do like, share, comment, and don't forget to subscribe. And please hit the bell icon, because after that you will be notified with every new video that I'm going to upload. See you very soon with rest of the videos upcoming soon. Till then, take care. Bye-bye.